الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى خصوصا على سيدنا وسندنا ومولانا محمد المصطفى صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد: وننزل من القرآن ما هو شفاء ورحمة للمؤمنين ولا يزيد الظالمين إلا خسارا. صدق الله مولانا العظيم. الصلاة والسلام عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Dear respected viewers and listeners, brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah, we are now into the part four of this series on the da'il of the month of Ramadan. Alhamdulillah, I have had the honor of talking about the virtues of fasting and the virtues of the month of Ramadan. And today, inshallah, I want to talk about a very important subject that is related to Ramadan but also related to our general lives. And that subject is none other than the virtues and the importance of building a connection with the glorious Quran. Many great authors have come in the past. Many great stories have been written. Many great narrations have been narrated. Many great books have been written as well. However, there is no book that is greater than the book that is called the Quran. There is no message greater than the messages of the Quran. There is no one has written a book like that which has been given to the Ummah of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, none other than the Quran. No great narrations or stories have been narrated in a book greater than the book known as Al-Quran. Alhamdulillah, being in the Ummah of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, we count ourselves and we should count ourselves fortunate that we have received the greatest of all books, the leader of all books. Sayyidul Kutub, the leader of all books, none other than the Quran. This Quran is something that sadly today we have left on our shelves to gather dust. Illa mashaAllah, there are exceptional people who today still open the Quran, have a connection to it. However, on the whole, in general, the Quran is just a book that is gathering dust on our shelves. Whether you go into the masjid and you will see there will be shelves of Qurans there, so many Qurans that wallahi, in my limited short age, I have seen many Qurans in the mosques, but they just sit there and they are gathering dust there. Nobody wants to pick the Quran up today. The youth are not interested. They have no connection, no nisbat to it. Why? What are the reasons for this? As I've mentioned previously, external influences. Sadly, today the Quran has been replaced by the Kindle. The Quran has been replaced by the iPod. The Quran has been replaced with music, sadly. And we have become misguided and we have lost our nisbat and connection to the Quran. The very famous hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the occasion of Hajjatul Wida, the final sermon the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam gave. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam mentioned many things in this sermon. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam spoke about racism on this khutbah. This khutbah was a khutbah that changed the course of humanity. It's something that needs to be spoken about today. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said that there is no difference between a black man and a white man. There is no difference between an Arab and a non-Arab. The only way you can assess or you can make a difference between people is through the pious and piety and the pious actions that one does. Taqwa. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran said, Inna akramakum indallahi atqakum. Indeed, the noblest of you, the best amongst you, are the ones who are the most pious. They have the greatest rank. Not the one who is the most wealthiest. Not the one who has the most respect. Not the one who has the best clothes, who has the best car. But it's the one who has the most God-fearing qualities inside him. The one who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who is close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who performs the most good deeds. The one who has the sahih al-aqidah, the correct belief and doctrine. It is these people who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Habib alayhi salam said, they are the best people. Nabi alayhi salatu salam, on the final sermon, they also mentioned that be careful in regards to the women. They are an amanat from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And today, look at the state, how women are being treated, sadly being tortured, whether it's physical abuse, mental abuse, domestic violence, so many issues that are occurring in our households, whether it's the husband beating the wife up. At times you will find that the wife beats the husband up. Very rarely, but yes, that's the case as well you will get. However, you see a sad reality, sad state that we're in. How the rights of women are neglected. How we have begun to treat them like the days of ignorance. Again, another topic that needs to be discussed is the rights of women in Islam, the status of a woman in Islam. Honored are the sisters and brothers. Honored are you sisters. That you have the role models. You have such role models, such as Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, Sayyidah Fatimah Zahra radiallahu ta'ala anha, such as Sayyidah Khatijatul Kubra radiallahu ta'ala anha, the great Azwajul Mutahharat, the great pious, pure wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You have so many great role models. Today, however, our sisters choose to follow the actresses, they choose to follow the people of the dunya rather than those that will benefit them in the akhirah and also in this dunya. One of the things Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said is that, O my companions, I leave behind you two things. If you hold on to these two things, then you will be guided. You will never be misguided. The first is the Quran. Hold on to the Quran. And the second is my sunnah and my way. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. Hold on to the rope of Allah. The Mufassirun have written that here, the Hablillah, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ, the rope of Allah, is the Al-Quran Al-Kareem. If we hold on to the Quran, we will never be misguided. Sadly today, whether it's politicians running the world, whether it's people on ground level, whether it's brothers and sisters in their houses, whether it's anything, any sphere, wherever there's Muslims, the moment the Muslims left the connection of the Quran, it was at that moment that Muslims became. And those who are against Islam, they have found a weak spot. Take the Quran from their lives. Take the Sunnah from their lives. And today, the time has come when we need to rebuild our connection with the Quran. And for that, one needs to understand. The Quran was revealed in the month of Ramadan. The Quran was revealed in the month of Ramadan. And such that the verses were Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. The Quran was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and khasatan in particular the ummah of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam performed many miracles. Where does one begin? Imam Suyuti rahmatullah alayhi, Qadi Iyad even mentions that there are over 3,000 miracles of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam split the moon into two halves with their finger. When the sun has set And Sayyidina Ali Sheri Khuda did not perform the Salatul Asr and Maghrib had set in. Nabi alayhi salatu salam's ghulam and sahabi and Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala and they needed to perform the Salatul Asr and Nabi alayhi salatu salam returned the sun after it had set so that Hazrat Ali Sheri Khuda could perform the Salatul Asr. Nabi alayhi salatu salam could see in darkness what they could see in light. Sayyida Aisha radiyallahu ta'ala anha, she used to say, Tara ma la nara ya Rasulullah. O Allah Almighty's Messenger, you see what we cannot see. Nabi alayhi salatu salam could see in front of them, just as they could see behind them, just as they could see in front of them. They could see in darkness, just as bright as they could see in light, when there was daylight. These miracles of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Trees would come walking to Nabi alayhi salatu salam. Stones would give salam to Rasulullah alayhi salam. Mountains began to shake when Nabi alayhi salam's qadmain touched them. Ash-Sharifain sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These mu'jizat of Rasulullah alayhi salatu salam were performed as a miracle, as a sign, as a dalil of the nabuwat of Rasulullah alayhi salatu salam given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the greatest miracle and the miracle that lives today is the miracle of the Quran. 1400 years have passed. Bring me one person in the history who has been able to tamper or change one word, one letter of the Quran. Do you know why? Because Allah Almighty in the Quran Himself challenged man. Allah Almighty said, "Qul in kuntum tuhibbuna." Allah Almighty in the Quran clearly said, "Wa in kuntum fi raybin mimma nazzalna ala abdina fa'tu bi suratin min mithlih." And if you have doubt in what we have revealed to our servant, then bring one verse, one ayah like this. Bring one thing like this. In kuntum sadiqeen, if you are truthful. فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا وَلَن تَفْعَلُوا فَاتَّقُوا النَّارَ الَّتِي وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ أُعِدَّتْ لِلْكَافِرِينَ. Allah Almighty said, فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا, and if you cannot do, and then He said, وَلَن تَفْعَلُوا, you will never be able to do. You will never be able to bring a surah, a verse from the verses of the Quran. Allah Almighty openly challenged man. Till today, this challenge is open to the entire world. Till today, there has not been a single person who has been able to alter or change the Quran. You know why? The world is trying to remove the Quran, burn the Quran, do all these things. We know what's happening in the media at this moment in time. But look, subhanAllah, this Quran is such a powerful book that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, "Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafizun." We were the ones who revealed this remembrance and we will be the ones who will protect this remembrance. And how has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected? Allahu Akbar, look at the shan of a believer. Look at your maqam. Look at the maqam of a hafiz of the deen, hafiz of the Quran. The person who's memorized every single verse in the Quran by heart, they can burn as many Qurans as they like. They can do all of these things, try to distort the Quran, but the Quran that is in the heart of a believer, they will never be able to burn this. They will never be able to burn the heart. How many Qurans, how many Hufaz are there in the world? There is no book that is memorized more than the Quran is being memorized. There is no book that is being sold more in America than the Holy Quran. Look at that. Look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works. When big disasters and certain acts of extremism occur, Allah Almighty gives rank and honor to the Quran, that the Quran is the most sold book after 9/11. Look at the shan of the Quran. Look at the status of the Quran. Allah said, "We reveal the Quran and we will protect the Quran." How? We will preserve it in the hearts of man. Man will remember and preserve in his mind and in his heart, and nobody can distort the teachings of the Quran. Such a Quran that today we can bring forth, one would say, "Theek hai, Imam Sahib, you make a fair point. It's the most memorized book. 40-year-olds will memorize it, 30-year-olds. But yakeenan in our history, we have had people who when they were born, they were hafiz of 15 saparas of the Quran. In Shaykh Abdul Qadir Jilani, it's narrated about شيخ عبد القادر جيلاني رضي الله تعالى عن الغوث الأعظم شهباز لامقاني غوث جيلان in regards to them that when they came into this dunya when they were born they went to their teacher and the teacher said read and they began to read and continued like this and the teacher the parent of the parents and the of Sayyidina Huzur Ghawth Jilan said to the teacher teach my son and when they began to teach Fatiha Huzur Ghawth Jilan said I know this teach me something else and they said every time they taught them something new they said I know this when they arrived at the 15th juz of the Quran they said I have memorized 15 juz of the Quran where did Shaykh Abdul Qadir Jilani memorize this when they were in the stomach of the blessed mother Sayyida Fatima rahmatullah alayha when they were in her stomach at that time when the mother was doing her daily chores at home Allahu Akbar she would constantly do tilawat of the Quran and Sayyidina Huzur Ghawth Jilan memorized the Quran whilst being in the blessed stomach and womb of the mother of Sayyidina Ghawth Jilan Sayyida Fatima rahmatullah alayha so we've had Hufaz who have been hafiz of Nisful Quran, even the entire Quran, even before they were born when they came into this dunya, were hafiz of the Quran. Imam Suyuti, the likes of Imam Jalaluddin Suyuti, Imam Shafi'i, they were hafiz of the Quran by the age of 6 and 7 years old, respectively. By the age of 6 and 7 years old, they were hafiz of the Quran. They had memorized the entire book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu Akbar, look how much love our people have. Make your children hufaz of the Quran. Make them people who want to memorize the Quran, fall in love with the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this Quran, Allah said He has protected it. Allah Almighty has challenged mankind to bring a verse like it, unchallenged till today. Nobody has been able to bring this. Allah has protected the Quran, the Hufaz have memorized the Quran. It's even narrated that the Quran talks about the past and the future. That Quran talks about Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. As Yusuf alayhi salam came before the Quran was revealed. The Quran talks about Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam. Stories of the past, parables of the past. The Quran talks about the present times. What is happening at this moment in time in the world. Or what was happening in the time of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. And the Quran talks about the future. Ghulibatir Rum. Rome will be conquered. Allahu Akbar. The Quran has foreseen this. The Quran has told us about this miracle. The Quran, even before science was revealed, even before science came into full throttle and action, embryology, sociology, mathematics, you name all these subjects you will find them in the Quran.
Mera har white pearls ka itni khubiyon ka ek naam white pearl.
You will find science in the Quran. You will find mathematics in the Quran. You will find sociology in the Quran. You will find psychology in the Quran. You will find all these things in the Quran. You talk about literature. There is no greater book of literature than the Quran. There is nothing more eloquent and fasih and baligh than the Quran. The Quran is such a book that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no man could have bought this. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam did not make the Quran. This is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam taught the Quran. Nobody can alter the word of Allah Almighty. A dalil, one of the greatest dalils of Tawheed. A dalil of the risalat and nabuwat of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. And if the Quran is a universal book, then the sahib Quran is a universal Nabi. If the Quran is a book that was revealed to entire mankind, then Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam was a Nabi and Rasul that came to entire mankind. If the Quran is alive today, then Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam is spiritually alive today as well. How can you have the Quran and not the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam? How can you have Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam and not have the Quran? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the Quran Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, Alif Lam Mim, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ Alif Lam Mim. These particles, these letters, حروف مقطعات, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Nabi alayhi salatu salam know its true meaning. Not even Sayyidina Jibreel knows what it means. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ. This is the book. لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. There is no doubt inside this book. Anyone who has shak or shubha in the Quran is outside the fold. Why? To doubt a verse of the Quran is doubting the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hudan lil muttaqeen, it's a book of guidance. It's the book that guides the pious people. Yudillu bihi kathira wa yahdi bihi kathira. Allah Almighty said this is a book that has guided many and misguided many. Now the Quran, yakeenan, is a book of guidance. There is no misguidance involved in the Quran. But the moment a person picks the Quran up and he thinks he knows what's happening in the Quran, he thinks he knows what is being said in the Quran, and he becomes a self-acclaimed teacher of the Quran, then he can become misguided through his own understanding of the Quran. But the Quran is not a book of misguidance. People have misguided themselves thinking that they know what the Quran is. It's like me walking into a doctor's surgery and me picking up a manual of the doctor's surgery, or me picking up a manual and the teachings of how to become a doctor. Does that make me a doctor? No. For me to become a doctor, I would need experience. I would have to go to university and to an institute. I would have to go and study. Today everyone thinks they are a mufassir. Today everyone thinks they are a muhaddis. They can do darse Quran. They can teach the Quran when they have no, they lack knowledge of the Quran. Leave this duty to the ulama. Leave this duty to the scholars. Become a student of the deen and study in the footsteps of the scholars. Inshallah al-Aziz, we will have a short break. After the break, we shall return and continue with this subject. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Dear respected viewers and listeners, brothers and sisters, welcome back after the break. Prior to the break, I spoke about the virtues of the Quran, the importance of the Quran and connection to the Quran, and I spoke about the verses where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the Quran. Allah Almighty has mentioned in the Quran, Inna nahnu nazalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafizun. We were the ones who revealed the Quran and we will be the ones who will protect it. The Quran is a book of cure and mercy and rahmah. Allah Almighty in the Quran said, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And we have revealed in the Quran that which is a cure. That which is a cure. وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And a mercy for the believers. Allah Almighty Himself has clearly stated in the Quran that the Quran is a cure. A Quran is a cure to the spiritual diseases. Quran is a cure to anything that is done upon a person. The Quran is a unlimited cure to everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself has said there is shifa in the Quran. So shifa in the wordings of the Quran, shifa in the tilawat of the Quran, shifa in listening to the Quran. Allahu Akbar. It was the Quran when Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala and listened to the Quran. The verses of Surah Taha. Look at the shan of Hazrat Umar Farooq. When Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu wanted to end Islam, to kill the Prophet alayhi salatu salam prior to becoming a Muslim, they went and they were on the street marching. And Sayyidina Umar took the sword out. And they said, where is Muhammad? I want to kill him. He has divided our families into pieces. Son has gone against his father, daughter has gone against his mother. He's gone against the religion of our forefathers. There was somebody there, a Sahabi, who was hiding his Islam and said, Umar, never mind the Prophet alayhi salam, your sister has become a Muslim. Sayyidina Umar's attention immediately diverted towards the house of his sister. His sister's name was Fatima and she had become a Muslim. And Sa'id ibn Zayd, who was one of the 10 companions that Nabi alayhi salam gave glad tidings of Jannah to, Sayyidina Sa'id ibn Zayd was the husband, so the brother-in-law. And Sayyidina Khabbab radiallahu anhu, Sayyidina Khabbab, he was to teach Sayyidina Umar, or he was teaching Sayyidina Sa'id and Sayyidina Fatima, the sister and brother-in-law of Sayyidina Umar Farooq radiallahu ta'ala and the Quran at that time. When Sayyidina Umar arrived, they knocked on the door. Sayyidina Umar said, open the door. Sayyidina Fatima said, who is it? Said, it's Umar bin al-Khattab. Open the door immediately. When Sayyidina Fatima opened the door, Sayyidina Umar said, what are you reading? Sayyidina Umar punched their sister and she began to bleed. Began beating Sayyidina Sa'id ibn Zayd. سيدنا خباب began to hide behind the corner. سيدنا رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام used to say, Umar, even Shaitan is scared of you. سيدنا خباب decided they're going to hide behind. خير. Then سيدنا عمر found سيدنا خباب began to beat him up. Afterwards, mercy came into the heart of سيدنا عمر. سيدنا عمر said to their sister, seeing the sight of their sister bleeding, bruised, my sister, tell me, what were you reading? And she said, you are not allowed to touch this book except if you are in the state of purity. Sayyidina Umar went and performed wudu and then began to read the verses of Surah Taha. Allahu Akbar, look at the shan of Hazrat Umar Farooq. They knew and they understood this Quran. These verses were a shifa. Sayyidina Umar had a disease in their heart that was hatred towards Islam. And the Quran cured this disease. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, prior to the acceptance of Islam of Sayyidina Umar, they used to make a dua that, O Allah, strengthen Islam with either one of the two Umars that you love. O Allah, whoever of the two Umars you love, you strengthen Islam. Umar ibn Hisham, aka Abu Jahl, known as Abu Jahl, or Umar bin al-Khattab. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, when the dua was accepted, who did Allah Almighty love? Allah Almighty loved Umar Farooq. Allah Almighty brought Umar Farooq to Islam, guided Sayyidina Umar to Islam. And when Sayyidina Umar went to the house of Sayyidina Rasulullah alayhi salam, they were staying in Darul Arkam, knocked on the door. And Sayyidina Amir Hamza was standing there. And Hazrat Amir Hamza said, who is it? And he said, Umar bin al-Khattab. Sayyidina Hamza said, what do you want? Remember Sayyidina Hamza, radiyallahu ta'ala an, he was the great Asadullah wa Asadur Rasul. He was known as the Lion of Allah and His Rasul. Sayyidina Hamza said, what do you want, Umar? He said, I've come to accept Islam. Sayyidina Hamza said, if you've come to accept Islam, Bismillah, come. But if you've come to stop Islam or fight, then I will kill you with your own sword. Look at the maqam and the rank of Sayyidina Hamza radiyallahu anhu. Then Nabi Islam said, allow Umar to come in. When Sayyidina Umar entered into the house, at that time, Allahu Akbar, the Sahaba, they began to cry at the joy of knowing that Umar bin al-Khattab has become a Muslim. That this great warrior, who is known as the best fighter in the Arab world, he has accepted Islam. And when they heard, there was such a takbir of Allahu Akbar that beckoned through the mountains of Makkah Mukarrama, that even the mushrikeen in Makkah today knew that Umar bin al-Khattab had become a Muslim. Nabi alayhi salam said, Umar, every devil on the earth fears you, every angel in the sky respects you. The rank of Sayyidina Umar, when Sayyidina Umar accepted Islam, Nabi alayhi salam touched the chest of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu and said, O Allah, remove the hatred of Islam from his heart and substitute it with Iman. And Hazrat Umar Farooq became Al-Mu'min Al-Kamil, the most pure believer from all of the Sahaba Ridwanullahi ta'ala min ajma'in. He was the leader. Sayyidina Ali karamallahu ta'ala wajhahu al-kareem used to say, Ali, Abu Bakr and Umar are the mother and father of Islam. They are the foundational blocks of Islam. So Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu received the guidance through the cure of the Quran. The Quran is what cured Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu ta'ala. And this Quran is a cure to all diseases. Whether it's physical, whether it's spiritual, whether it's mental, the Quran is a cure. Whether you listen to it, whether you read it, whether it's recited upon you, the Quran is a cure. Allah has said this in the Quran. What greater dalil do somebody need? When Allah Himself has said, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَى. And we have revealed that which in the Quran is a cure. وَرَحْمَى and a mercy for who? It's sakoon, aman, itminan, rahat for who? The people of Iman. The mu'mineen love reciting the Quran, love connecting to the Quran. Allah Almighty has also mentioned that the Quran is an explanation for everything. وَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. And we have sent upon you a book that explains to everything to you. Everything is explained in this book. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, in another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that the Quran is a universal message. Ya ayyuhan nas qad ja'atkum maw'izatun min rabbikum wa shifa'un lima fi suduri wa hudan wa rahmatun lil mu'minin. Again, the word shifa has been used. Allah Almighty has said, O people, Allah Almighty in this ayat of the Quran addressed the people, entire mankind. Allah didn't just address the believers. He didn't say, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. Allah Almighty said, Ya ayyuha nas. Everyone, O people, mushrik, non-mushrik, Muslim, non-Muslim, everyone, listen up. قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِذَةٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. Certainly, there is a maw'idha. There is a message that has come to you from your Lord. وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ. And a cure to the diseases that are in the heart. وَهُدَى وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And it's a guidance and a mercy for those who believe. The Quran is a book of guidance and a book of mercy to those who want to take guidance and mercy from the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the power of the Quran, the greatness of the Quran. Allah Almighty said, لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله وتلك الأمثال نضربها للناس لعلهم يتفكرون. In Surah Al-Hashr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل. Look at the power of the Quran here. Allah Almighty said, if we had revealed this Quran upon a mountain, لرأيته, you would have seen it. من خشية الله. You would have seen it. The mountain began to shake out of fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The mountain, a normal mountain, cannot bear the weight of the power of the Quran. I pick a qasam by Allah, do you really know what the power of the heart of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam is? The Quran was revealed upon the qalb athar of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It was revealed into the heart of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, the Quran. Allah Almighty said, if we reveal it on a mountain, the mountain would have shooken. It would have begun to shake out of fear of Allah. But the heart of Rasulullah, imagine the quwwat in that heart. Imagine the strength of Rasulullah's heart. Nabi Salam isn't like me and you. Nabi Salam received the Quran. Nabi Salam was a muallim of the Quran, a teacher of the Quran. Nabi Salam could see in front of them what they could see behind them. What they could see behind them, what they could see in front of them. Nabi alayhi salam could see in darkness what they could see in light. Nabi alayhi salatu salam, water came out of their blessed fingers. They split the moon into two halves. Nabi alayhi salam returned the sun back after it had set. Nabi alayhi salatu salam would merely do ishara to the idols in the Kaaba and the idols would break. Nabi alayhi salatu salam, trees would come bowing to Rasulullah alayhi salam. Animals would do shikwa and complain to Rasulullah alayhi salatu salam. Look at the shan of Habib-e Kibriya. Sarvare kono makaj, ba'is-e arzo sama, rahmatan lil alamin, shafi'ul muznin, Sayyidina Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Can you imagine the shan of Rasulullah alayhi salatu salam? Can you imagine the status of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam? There is nobody like Nabi alayhi salatu salam. Nabi alayhi salatu salam came as a mercy to mankind. They brought the Quran, taught us the Quran. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam's heart, so much strength inside there. That Allah said, if it was revealed on a mountain, the mountain would have shook. But it was revealed into the heart of Rasulullah alayhi salam. Imagine the quwwat in the heart of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi alayhi salatu salam was able to handle the power of the Quran within the heart. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these are chand ayat, a few verses that I've selected from the Quran, which illustrate the importance of the Quran, the greatness of the Quran, the maqam of the Quran. The Quran is not like any ordinary book. The Quran is a book that has not been tampered. The Quran is a book that explains. The Quran is a book that cures people. The Quran is a book of mercy. The Quran is a book of guidance. The Quran is a book that people who read it, they find sukoon in their heart. The Quran is a book of sukoon. The Quran is a book of itminan, tranquility. The Quran is the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a form of dhikr of remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It continues even further. Sayyidina Abu Umama al-Bahli radiyallahu anhu, he said, hadith mentioned in Sahih Muslim, the Rawi is Abu Umama al-Bahli. He said, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, اِقْرَأُ الْقُرْآنَ. Read the Quran. Nabi alayhi salam said, read the Quran. فَإِنَّهُ يَأْتِي يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ شَفِيعًا لِصَاحِبِهِ. For indeed, it will come on the day of Qiyamah as something that will do shifa'at for the person who recites it. The person who reads the Quran will do shafa'at for it on the day of Qiyamah. As I mentioned before, on the day of Qiyamah, our halat, our state is going to be hard. We'll be in a difficult state. We will find it hard and difficult. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give power to the Quran to speak and say, intercede for the ones who are nisbat to you, those who are connected to you, those who used to recite you, intercede for them, help them now. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam mentioned in a hadith by Ibn Hibban, Sayyidina Jabir ibn Abdullah radiyallahu an is the rawi. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, Al-Quran was shafi'un wa mushafa'un. The Quran is a shafi', it is a thing that will intercede, and it's a mushaffa, it's something that whose intercession will be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It will intercede and its intercession will be accepted. وَحَامِلٌ مُصَدَّقٌ مَنْ جَعَلَهُ أَمَامَهُ قَادَهُ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever puts the Quran in front of him, whoever does adab to the Quran, whoever respects the Quran, it will take him to Jannatul Firdaus. Whoever puts the Quran behind him, disrespects the Quran, then it will drag him to the hellfire. This is what will happen. Make a nisbat and ta'alluq with the Quran. The month of Ramadan is a month in which you can have nisbat to the Quran. You can make connection to the Quran. The Quran will help you and will get you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَابْتَغُوا إِلَيْهِ الْوَسِيلَةِ and seek a means of approach to him. And a means of approach to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Quran, is ibadat, is all these things. Allahu Akbar. The Quran came through Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. You learn how to read namaz through Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. You got to know about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. You were taught the rulings of fasting through the teachings of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. Everything came through Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. So when one wants to go to Allah Almighty, he wants to take Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam out of the equation and go. But those who are believers in Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, they will say that to get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to go through Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. We learn about Allah Almighty, we got the ma'rifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. If the Quran is going to do shafa'at for you, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, the sahib Quran. If the Quran is a wasila to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam themselves are a means to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The people of Allah can become means to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look, a very famous story in the life of Sayyidina Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi. Imam al-A'zam, Imam Abu Hanifa, one of the greatest imams, if not the greatest imam of fiqh that has ever come. Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi, they themselves said, I was young, I was 18, 19, 20 years old. And I was going to the marketplace when I bumped into the likes of the Imam Sha'bi. Sha'bi was sat there and asked me, said, where are you going? And he said, Nu'man radiallahu anhu, Sayyidina Imam Abu Hanifa said that I'm going to the marketplace for my mother. And Sayyidina Imam Sha'bi, rahmatullah alayhi wa radiallahu ta'ala anhu, said that, oh Abu Hanifa, oh Nu'man, you have this quality inside you that you can become more religious and pious. Through the guidance and the advice and taking the means of Sayyidina Imam Sha'bi, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Imam Abu Hanifa started studying in the company of the ulama. Sat in the company of the Hammad ibn Abi Sulaiman. When they sat there at that time, that's when they learned the deen. But how did they get on the deen? Through the means of these great awliyaullah. They took the means of these people. The Quran is a means, ibadat and practical worship is a means, Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam is a means, and the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are a means to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our whole life's mission aim is to get close to Allah Almighty. And to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to attach yourself to those who are already close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you attach yourself to somebody who is far from Allah Almighty, how close will you get? This is why it's very important that we as Muslims, we try to build a connection with Rasulullah alayhi salam. We build a connection with the Quran. We build a connection in the month of Ramadan. This is the best month for us to build a connection with the Quran. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said that there are three people who will be under the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Complex chakwal ki deeda zeb imarat tayyar dukhi insaniyat ki madad aur apne pyaron ke isale under the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of qiyamah. Imam Baghawi narrates this in his book Sharh Sunnah. The one al-Quran, the Quran that the servant used to have, was muhtaj upon, who used to depend upon, that person who had nisbat to the Quran, He will be under the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on a day when there will be no shade except the shade of Allah's throne. The person who has nisbat to the Quran. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, when talking about the virtues of the Quran, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu ta'ala, and who was an expert in the teachings of the Quran, mentioned in Tirmizi Sharif, he said that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, whoever recites one harf, one letter in the Quran, then he will get 10 good deeds for reciting one letter in the Quran. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, wal hasanatu bi ashri amthaliha, and one good deed is equal to 10 good deeds. Man jaa bil hasanati, man jaa bil hasan falahu ashru amthaliha. The one who comes with one good deed, that Allah will reward him 10 times for. Nabi alayhi salam said, the one who recites one letter, he will get one deed that is equivalent to 10 good deeds. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam did say, la aqulu alif la meem harfun alif harfun lam lamun harfun alifun harfun meemun harf. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam didn't say that I am telling you alif lam meem is one harf. No, Nabi alayhi salam said alif is one harf, lam is one harf, meem is one harf. So if there are three letters, you will get 30 rewards for reciting three letters. Now imagine how many letters there are in the Quran and how much reward me and you can accumulate. But the world we live in, the Quran wants to be taken out of our hearts. People want us to be distanced from the Quran. They don't want attention to the Quran. That's why they're giving us novels and books and magazines to read. They're giving us iPods to play with. When the time of Imam Malik rahmatullah alayh, there was no iPod or no iPhone. There was no mobile phones. There was nothing distracting them. They had direct connection to the Quran. They sat, they learned the Quran. They asked the Sahaba, tell me, what does this mean? When was this revealed? What does this mean? What are the rulings for this? What's the understanding behind this? And this is what the Quran teaches me and you. The Quran teaches me and you a nisbat to it. And I believe, wallahi, in the day and age that we live, I certainly believe that if there's any a time that we are to connect back to the Quran, then it's the 21st century that today we are living in. Oh, my brothers and sisters, mothers and fathers, build a connection with the Quran. The Quran will be a companion in your grave. The Quran will be a companion on the day of Qiyamah. It will help you in your grave and it will help you on the day of judgment. The Quran is a way for you to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Quran was revealed in the month of Ramadan, in the month of this blessed month. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all tawfiq to have nisbat to the Quran, make us have ta'alluq to the Quran, rishta with the Quran, a connection with the Quran. When one is connected to the Quran, then he is connected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the Quran is the kalam of Allah Almighty. It's the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, an eternal word of Allah Almighty that has always been and will always be. Such that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallama, just on a negative point, it's not a negative point, but Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam emphasized the greatness of the Quran, such that they said, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma, he used to say that Nabi alayhi salam said that the one who in his heart there is no Quran, then he is like a destroyed house. The one who has no Quran in his heart is like a destroyed house. Hadith mentioned in Tirmizi Sharif. Everyone should learn at least one verse of the Quran, because if you don't have the Quran in your heart, then you will be destroyed. And alhamdulillah, we go to educational institutes and systems where the Quran is being taught. Not only do we learn to memorize the Quran, but also learn the meanings of the Quran and the understanding of the Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to act upon what I've said. Give me tawfiq to act upon what I've said. If anything wrong has been said, it's from me. All good is from Allah and His Habib, Sayyidina Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The du'as of my mothers and fathers. Allah bless all of you continuously, more so in this dunya, but even more in the akhirah. أقول قولي هذا أستغفر الله لي ولكم وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
رمضان آیا رمضان آیا ساتھ اپنے لایا ساتھ اپنے لایا ساتھ اپنے لایا ساتھ اپنے لایا نیکی کی خوشبو رحمت کا سایہ